take a look at end time lessons in Daniel chapters 1 to 6. And we are going to see maybe specifically how the experiences in Daniel, how things in Daniel that is written there, is, what can we say, a symbol, illustration of what will take place in the end times, which Revelation talks about. So I'm excited about this topic, and we will, I know you have been taking a look at Daniel already, I think with Max, and so it's also good with some repetition. We will not go into depth, but we will be mostly in Daniel chapter 3. So let us start with another word of prayer. Would any one of you like to pray? Really, would you like to pray?
Father, Father, we thank you so much that we have this opportunity to get into your word. And I pray that you please be with Christian as he teaches us, give him the guidance of your Holy Spirit, and help us to have understanding in these things. We pray and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay. I don't know if... Do you know that there is a chiastic structure of Daniel chapter 1 to 7? Did you learn anything about that here? You know what chiasm is? Let me just give you a few words on chiasm. In Bible, you find something, what can I say, Hebrew way of writing. We can think about it as, let us do it like this. Okay, let's say you have a thought here, A, B, and then we can have another B and then A. So here you have thought A, and then the passage goes on with the thought B, and then the thought B again, and then finally thought A. It's like a sandwich, we can say, double, like you have bread, and then maybe you have tomato and tofu, and then you have bread again. So basically, it can also be like a step ladder like this. You know, you have step here, step, and it goes toward a climax. Usually, and the reason why it was written like this is because the writer would like to make a point. I mean, they couldn't make, you know, the text bold or underline. I mean, they didn't do these things as we would do today if we want to focus on something and underline a thought. This is what they would do. Usually, the main thought would be in the center, but not always. The thing they wanted to focus on. And you have many different versions on how this could be. It can be A, B, C, C, B, A, and so on. I mean, it can be more. And usually you find it, maybe you can find it a lot in Psalms, for instance, this way of thinking or writing. And in Daniel, and in the chapters in Daniel, chapters 1 to 7, you find a big chiasm. For instance, so let us, oh, sorry, it's chapter 2, of course, chapter 2 to 7. And so what do you find in chapter 2? What's the main thought in chapter 2? Like, I mean, what's the rough outline of chapter, what is it? What are we seeing in chapter 2?
The story from the beginning to the end of that.
Okay, yeah, so we can say, can we say rise and fall of kingdoms? That could be the main thought, the rise and fall of kingdoms. And then down in chapter 3, there we find, what is happening there? Is the Daniel 3 friends, you're experiencing what? Persecution, right? So we can say persecution of the saints. Then Daniel chapter 4, what do we find there? We find Nebuchadnezzar, right? How he fell and then rose up again. So the rise and fall, or the fall and rise of a king. And then Daniel chapter 5, what do we find there? There was the judgment on Babylon, right? And when Medo Persia came, and it was Belshazzar. So the fall of King Belshazzar. And then Daniel chapter 6. What do we find there? Yeah, persecution again of Daniel, right? He was thrown into to the lion's den. And then Daniel chapter 7, again, rise and fall of kingdoms. So you see, so if you put them like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, oh sorry, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then you have the same thought in chapter 2 and chapter 7. And then chapter 3 and chapter 6, quite the same thought, the same thing that is happening. And then you find chapter 4 and 5, quite the same thoughts. So what you find is rise and fall of kingdoms, right? Rise and fall of kings, persecution of the saints by the state. Are these things that is happening in the end time? This is it has been taking place in history. It is taking place in the end time as well. But we know that God is in control, just like we see the prophecies that are fulfilled in the past. And praise God for that. We don't need to worry for the future. We have a few Bible texts here now I want to take a look at what has happened. We have in Hosea chapter 12, Hosea chapter 12, verse 10. Hosea 12, verse 10, it says, I have also spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied visions and used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. What does this text tell you? God says, He has used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. The word similitude, what does it mean? Being like something, right? Being like something. Like a parallel or a comparison. And I believe, if you see this in light with, for instance, Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 9 to 10, there it says, Ecclesiastes 9 and 10, the thing that has been is, it is what that we shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new. It has been already of old time, which was before us. Well, now we have to be careful when we look at these things, because some people take it to the extreme. And, you know, everything that happened before have to happen exactly like they have happened before. No, that's not what I'm trying to tell you. But I'm trying to tell you that history is repeating itself. The things that happened in the past, and I'm saying I'm not saying that prophecies are repeating themselves. I'm saying history is repeating itself, because some believe that the prophecies that they're all gonna be, you know, they're gonna fulfill twice. Well, I would rather say it's more correct to say the history. Ellen White talks about how the history will repeat itself. So has it repeated itself? Here we have some examples. We have Passover pointing to Christ. The thing that they needed to do. I mean, it was all pointing to Christ, the Passover lamb. We have 12 tribes of Israel, and then we have how many disciples and apostles? 12. We have Babylon of the old, and we have spiritual Babylon now. And we have persecution of God's people in the past. Through the ages, this has been going on. And we know this is going to be similar things taking place in the future. As in the past. So if you look at history, you see it's repeating itself. There's nothing new under the sun. So you see in the book of Revelation, for instance, it's using Babylon as a term. And how can we best understand what it means when Revelation talks about Babylon? What would be the most logical to do if you want to understand? I mean, what is Babylon? What is this thing?
Well, it won't be a literal Babylon because Babylon's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be spiritual.
Okay, so how can it help us understand what this spiritual Babylon is?
Look at its characteristics.
Yeah, remember the microphones. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, go on.
Looking at its characteristics in the literal sense, you can apply them in the spiritual sense.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
Yes, so we have to look at the old Babylon, right? Mm-hmm. The literal Babylon. That will help us to understand the spiritual Babylon. Mm-hmm. So we can learn from history what is going to take place. That will help us understand more, aha, so this is Babylon. And I hope you will see that today, in particular maybe this one. Because you see in Daniel, some of the end time lessons we will take a look at now. You can, by the way, go with me to Daniel chapter 3 now. Daniel chapter 3. And some of the end time lessons we will find here, because we saw that God has, through his prophets, he said in Hosea, he has used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. That's why we're going to look at it now, you know, what happened there. And so in Daniel chapter 3 in particular, and other places in Daniel, we find many end-time lessons, and many of them will be in relation to Antichrist, what is going to take place right before Jesus comes. And this makes it very relevant for us, because I believe we live in the very end. I believe that Christ is coming soon, because the prophecies are revealing that. So, in Daniel chapter 2, we know that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And what was his dream about again? About kingdoms, right? They had a statue with different metals, and you had a head of gold representing what? Babylon, okay, the head of gold. Remember this, because this will help us understand now what is happening in chapter 3. Okay, so in chapter 3, now let us, can some of you read verse 1? Chapter 3, Daniel 3, verse 1. Okay, Talika. Or Patrick, okay.
Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 60 cubits, and its width 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura, in the province of Babylon.
Okay, so Nebuchadnezzar, now he's making an image of gold. You know, when he got this dream in Daniel 2, we know that Babylon, this kingdom, they believed Babylon is going to last forever. You have these slogans almost, you know, may the king live forever, and they really thought the kingdom would last forever, and the head of gold, oh nice. But then when he heard about the other kingdoms, man, this cannot be. And now you see he's almost like rebelling against God. He's building an image of only gold now that is representing Babylon. So he's like he's challenging God and showing, well, no, my kingdom is going to last. And here you find numbers of 6, and this in the Babylonian system, they had this system, and we have, you know, when for instance in mathematics we have 10, they had 6 in their numerical systems, and as we see later in verse 5, they had 6 instruments that was going to play. We're getting there soon, but 6 is the number of who? Yeah. Number of man. Yes, so the number of the beast, we have 666, right? So 6 is the number of man. Man was created on day 6. So we have an image set up. And let's continue now, and I'll read verse 2. And the king Nebuchadnezzar sent word to gather together the satraps, the administrators, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So he's gathering all the people, right? All kinds of people to get there. And in verse 5, it says, then a herald cried out, to you it is commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages. So this is a command given to all nations. Come and gather. Something is going to take place here. And now, what happened? In verse 5, here comes the 5 instruments. It says that at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery in symphony with all kinds of music, you shall fall down and worship the gold image of that image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Okay, pretty serious stuff. I mean, we have music in combination with worship. When the music plays, they have to bow down to this image. So imagine the situation for God's people. I mean, they're here in Babylon. They hear this, and they're thinking, okay, what are we going to do? Well, I mean, we're in Babylon. I mean, can we just... I mean, we're in a new culture. Isn't it okay if we just bow down? I mean, God will understand. Would it be easy to think like that? I mean, yeah, I mean, this is the culture. We need to accept it and bow down. I mean, we can ask for forgiveness later. Or, you know, it's easy for us to start reasoning. And, you know, when we are in a situation like that, you know, I'll take the easy road. And I can always ask for forgiveness if this would be wrong. But if they would have bowed down, how many commandments would they break? At least. I would say at least two. Number one, you shall have no other gods before me. And number two, you shall not bow down and or should not have any images and so on, fall down and worship them. And, well, this of course would prove a weak faith if they would have done this. And not very good. And it will also prevent them from the greater things that they were able to do later. Because we know now they had a great witnessing opportunity, even though it would mean death penalty for them. I mean, everyone bows down and they stand. That would be, a great witness opportunity. And we also know that the result of this, and we'll get there, I mean, we know they got promoted as a result in the kingdom. And now they have a wide influence, you know. So this would never have happened if they would not have been faithful to God. A short story is me and my brother, when I worked as a nurse, or in fact it was during my education, and one day when I worked in the home nursing care, I felt this conviction that I was supposed to tell my patient that I went to that I will pray for her. You see, I was about to leave her home and I was like already on my way out the door, and I thought, no man, it's gonna be embarrassing. I cannot just turn up. Oh, by the way, I'm gonna pray for you. I was like, nah, it's gonna be weird. But because I had read a quote from Ellen White which says that every good impression comes from the Spirit of God. But in other words, if you feel that impressed to do something that is clearly for good, it's from the Holy Spirit. You need to evaluate every situation, of course, to be sure that this is from God. But I was like, no, this will be embarrassing. And I left. And I felt so bad. Man, like, God, please give me a new opportunity. I'm so sorry. And next week, I got the same opportunity. I got to go to this home again. And I was like, now I'm going to tell her. Patient, and she was feeling quite bad, I mean physically, and I also, I don't know, she seemed sad, and I was gonna just give her some medication and she or help her getting it, but she looked worse, in worse condition. Then I told her, look, I'm gonna pray for you, don't worry. And this led me into a good discussion with her, and I saw that when I left, I saw a peace there that I didn't see when I came. And praise God for that. And then a few days later, I heard the news that this lady had suddenly died. No one knew that she was, you know, sick. They had found that she had cancer in her whole body. No one knew that. And what would have happened if I would not have taken the opportunity God gave me? I mean, it could have been an eternal difference in her life. I don't know if what I told her was what she really needed before she died. I don't know. But my point is, when God tells us something, do it. I mean, don't be afraid for what people are going to think of you. And here we have Daniel's three friends. I mean, the thought probably came, what are they going to think of us? And what is going to happen with us now? So let us continue and see what happens in the story. And by the way, Ellen White has this quote, very interesting, and this is a big lesson for us. These three Hebrews possessed genuine sanctification. True Christian principle will not stop to weigh the consequences. It does not ask, what will people think of me if I do this? Or how will it affect my worldly prospects if I do that? With the most intense longing, the children of God desire to know what He would have done, would have them do, that their works may glorify Him. The Lord has made ample provision that the hearts and lives of all His followers may be controlled by divine grace, that they may be as burning and shining lights in the world. So this is basically what I said. I mean, we're not to stop and wait, you know, okay, if I do this, how is it going to affect me? What will the consequences be if I do this that God has called me to? No, we're not to do that. We are just to follow what thus says the Lord. Very important. And we saw here that, well, we know that, I mean, even this thought is so vitally important in the end time. Because if we stop and weigh, what will be the consequences if I refuse to follow this laws regarding Sunday? I mean, that's a big test. I mean, if we start, now we have the time to prepare for these times when many laws will be passed that's going to go against God's word. And we need to prepare for that. I mean, it's not a time for us to stop and think, well, let's see if I can get around this somehow. No. Basically, by showing loyalty to Nebuchadnezzar and bowing down, those who refuse this would get death penalty. And Nebuchadnezzar, in a sense, is making himself God. I mean, like I said, he wanted, it's like a rebellion to put a big image only in gold, and it's almost like bowing to him. And we know Antichrist is making himself God. And this is a good example how the spiritual Babylon, how Antichrist is going to act in the end. And we know a few quotes on music, because we have music here. And music, do you believe Satan is using music in the end time? Mm-hmm. I mean, music is, I really like music, and like Ellen White says, used rightly, it's a blessing. But she says here in second selected messages, page 38, those things which have been in the past will be in the future. Satan will make music a snare by the way in which it is conducted. God calls upon his people who have the light before them in the word and in the testimony to read and consider and to take heed. So this, I mean, she's pointing out music especially that will be made a snare by Satan. And it's in the way that it is conducted. So we need to, this is a topic we need to know something about, so we can know the deception. Mm-hmm. And we can know what the pure music that comes from God. It is uplifting. Mm-hmm. Here's another quote from it's two pages before, in Selected Messages, page 36. I'm sure some of you are familiar with this quote. It says that, you know, they had a camp meeting, I think, in Indiana, and she says that God showed her that what would take place just before the close of probation in relation to what happened at this camp meeting. And she says, every uncouth thing will be demonstrated. There will be shouting with drums, music, and dancing. The senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. And this is called the moving of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit never reveals itself in such methods, in such a bedlam of noise. This is an invention of Satan to cover up his ingenious methods for making of none effect the pure, sincere, elevating, ennobling, sanctifying truth for this time. Better never have the worship of God blended with music than to use musical instruments to do the work which last January was presented to me would be brought into our camp meetings. The truth for this time is nothing of this kind in his work on converting souls. A bedlam of noise shocks the senses and perverts that which, if conducted aright, might be a blessing. The powers of satanic agencies blend with the din and noise to have a carnival, and this is termed the Holy Spirit's working. pretty serious quote. I mean, and pretty uncomfortable too, for at least it has for me. I mean, I've been listening to all kinds of music earlier, and this is a touchy topic, because music is something that really is affecting us a lot and ties us in a certain way. And but she warns for this. By the way, let me say, I don't believe that the instruments in themselves are evil, that there is any instrument in itself, but it's the way they are used. Do you know? You know, you have. I mean, as Adventists, I mean, we know one of the instruments we were maybe talking about is drums, right? You know what the drum set also is called, the set of the drums. Trap set. Actually, the way that a drum set is supposed to be used in many times, and this is a deep topic, I'm not going to go deep into it, but many times it will be used wrong. And by the way, the main drum that is keeping the beat is called snare drum. Anyhow, but she specifically is using, she mentioned one instrument here, and that is drums, and she has music and dancing. So if you're interested in learning more, I can really recommend Christian Berdahl. Maybe some of you have heard of him. You can watch his series for free on YouTube called The Distraction Dilemma. I can write it down maybe later. But Distraction Dilemma, you find it on YouTube. Christian Berdahl with Shepherd Calls Ministry. But anyhow, I want to make a point. We see here that this will be repeated in the future. Music and worship, this is going to affect people. And I believe we see this, that Satan has entered with this in the church, as she warned about, and already started to happen at her time. Okay, let's continue. So here, we have 5 points so far here that we see. An image is set up. Keep your finger there and go to Revelation 13. Just so you will see it. Keep your finger in Daniel 3 and go to Revelation 13. And you can also keep a finger in Revelation 13 if you have two fingers. Because we'll go a little bit back and forth now so that you see the connection. Okay, Revelation 13, verses 11 to 15. Could we have one of you read it loud and clear? Maybe Danny, do you want to read it? Okay. Revelation 13, 11 to 15.
And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth, by the means of those miracles which he hath power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast which hath had the wound by a sword, and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak, and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed.
Okay, thank you. So, quite interesting, huh? We see the experience in the time of Daniel going to be repeated in the end. We see an image set up. We see all peoples and nations must worship. The same is in Daniel 3. We see a combination of religion and state, right? Worship, and then the state is commanding. We see death penalty for those who refuse to worship, as they say what worship is. And then number 5, a speaking with the voice of a dragon. Did Nebuchadnezzar speak with the voice of a dragon, you think? Let me show an interesting quote from Ellen White on this. But we see that, I mean, in Revelation, we see the this beast, the second beast of Revelation 13. It looked like a lamb, but had the voice of a dragon, right? Let us see what Ellen White says in the Bible Commentary, Volume 7, page 976. It says, history will be repeated. False religion will be exalted. The first day of the week, a common working day, possessing no sanctity whatsoever, will be set up as was the image at Babylon. She's like, well, look back to Babylon. That will teach us here. All nations and tongues and peoples will be commanded to worship this spurious Sabbath. This is Satan's plan to make of no account the day instituted by God and given to the world as a memorial of creation. The decree enforcing the worship of this day is to go forth to all the world. In a limited degree, it has already gone forth. In several places, the civil power is speaking with the voice of a dragon, just as the hidden king spoke to the Hebrew captives. So we have here Nebuchadnezzar, he's speaking with the voice of a dragon. And, you know, look, and you see that, of course, in the context, well, what he's basically saying. I mean, so we have speaking with the voice of a dragon. Okay, and let us now see. So we will basically have a false unity in the end. A unity that may appear good to the world, but we know that this is a bad idea. Unity based on the wrong principles. Let us continue in verses 7 to 11 here. So basically it said that they were falling down in verses 7 to 11 in Daniel 3, 7 to 11. But then what happened in verse 8 is talking about that the Chaldeans came forward and accused the Jews. Verse 9, they spoke and said to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, in symphony with all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the gold image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into the midst of burning fiery furnace. So here we have, they're complaining. They're like, look, I mean, you told us this, right? Is it true? And then we have, then they're coming with an accusation here against God's people. Verse 12. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. So we have God's faithful one that gets caught. You think in the end time that people will turn God's faithful ones in and say, look, this, I mean, you told this decree, but look at these guys, they're not following it. You know, these Adventists, that they're keeping the Sabbath, they refuse to worship the image, worship the beast. What are you going to do to them? Look, now we have to punish them. Look, this is going to take place in the future, just like here. If we are faithful, we will be accused by people. They will turn us into the authorities of the state. So then in verse 13 to 15, then it says, then Nebuchadnezzar, in rage and fury, gave the command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them, Is it really true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up? And now he gives them a second chance in verse 15. Like, you know, okay, you can do this again. But if you don't, I will cast you, you'll be cast immediately into the burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? He says. And You remember the answer from these three brave guys? Imagine here they're talking to the head of the state, the big power of that time. And this is what they're saying in verse 16. O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. That seems a little bit rude. But I don't think they were rude. They were just firm to their standards. They say, if that is the case, our God whom that we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. What a firm faith and Christian principle they have. This is what God's remnant people need to have in the end times. We need to act like them. I mean, we need to get this close relationship with God, that this is the answer we would get. I mean, we would give to people, to the authorities, to whoever wants to control us and make us worship and go against God's commandments. This is vitally important. Okay, so then what points do we see here now, what we have read? They are like, I mean, they want to keep God's commandments, right? So this is another end-time lesson, keeping God's commandments. We know that from Revelation, right, that God's people will keep his commandments. And then, of course, we have the persecution here. And in Revelation 12, chapter 13 to 17, we will not read all of it, but just take a look at it. Revelation 12, verses 13 to 17 is describing, you know, the dragon was persecuting the woman, the church. We will actually go through chapter 12 later on. So we'll not take a deep look at it now. But God is, you know, is helping the church and giving the church shelter. That she might fly into the wilderness, verse 14. And then the serpent, that is Satan, he was, you know, coming with a flood after the woman, sending a flood of people trying to get rid of the woman. But then the earth helped the woman. And in verse 17, we have the famous verse, and the dragon was enraged with the woman and went to make war with a remnant of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So here we have the persecution of the remnant of the church, the remaining ones. So, and these people, they will also be people that are following God wherever he goes in the end. We know that in Revelation 14, following the Lamb wherever he goes. And also a point is, they were not defiled by Babylon. These three, and Daniel also, they were not defiled by Babylon. Even with a Babylonian influence around them, they could stand firm to God's principles. They chose to do so because they had a close relationship with God. And God's people, they will be, in the end, will be the only ones that are not defiled with Babylon, with spiritual Babylon, with the doctrines, with, yeah. And you can find that in Revelation 14, the description there of the 144,000, not defiled by, the impure woman, the fallen churches. All right.
Sorry.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. You want to write? Yeah. And there's another point, number 10, innocent before God. Can some of you read for me, or for us, Daniel 6:22. This is about Daniel in the lion's den. Daniel 6:22. Here we find an interesting verse. Maybe Caroline, can you read for us? Take the microphone and Daniel 6:22. sin.
Okay.
Oh, you have it? Okay.
Daniel 6:22. Mm-hmm. My God have sent his angel, and I've shut the lions' mouths, that they have not hurt me. For much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O King, have I done no hurt.
Mm-hmm. So innocency was found in Daniel. He was found innocent before him. He was not hurt. And in Daniel chapter 1, verse 4, it says, talking about these people, the children in whom was no blemish. They were innocent before God. They had this relationship with God that was giving them skillful in all wisdom and knowledge and understanding, it says there. Again, Revelation 14:5 is describing this, the 144,000. Will be like this. Number 11 is, we know that these people, they were going to be thrown into the fire. Let's go to Daniel again, Daniel 3:19-23. So yes, you see, we go back and forth like this now to get the points. 19-23, it says, then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed towards Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke in commandment that they heat the furnace seven times more than it was usually heated. So this is very, very hot. And he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their trousers, their turbans, and their outer garments, and they were cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's command was urgent and the furnace exceeding hot, the flame of the fire killed those who took them. So then they were thrown there, and the people that did it got killed right away. And what about the end times? We know that ultimately those who try to destroy us, they will be destroyed themselves one day. God's people will indeed be tried in the fire. The Revelation 3 describes also refining experience to buy gold tried in fire. It says in the message to Laodicea. And indeed, it will be persecution as we have seen in the very end. So the God's last people will have a special purifying experience as of a similar character as we see in Daniel 3. Verse 24 and 25 in Daniel 3, it says, King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he arose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, Did we not cast three men bound in the midst of the fire? They answered and said to the king, True, O king. Look, he answered, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. How could he say that? How could he say it's like the Son of God? You think he had been told about the Son of God? We'll get back to that. Revelation 12, verse 14. We have seen it already that we know for 1260 years they were persecuted, and also in the end they will be of similar character, not a definite time though. And in Revelation 7, verses 1-3, it's talking about how the four angels standing by the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind shall not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on the tree, or any tree. And tree is a symbol of people in the Bible. You see that in Psalms 92, verse 12, for instance. Psalms 92, 12. And then there was another angel coming, crying to this, to these angels, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Do you think God cares for his children, his people? God really cares, and he wants the best for everyone. And he has everything under control. And just as we see the Son of Man, Jesus was in the fiery furnace together with these three men. He is going to be with his people as they are in a fiery persecution. He's going to be with us people just as he was with his people in the wilderness through the ages and took care of them and nourished them there. He's going to be with us also in these end times. And he's not going to let all these judgments come upon the earth before God's people are sealed. And it's decided and everything is clear. Okay. Number 13. Do we see a wound that was healed? We know that it is said about the first beast of Revelation 13, right? The papacy, the Antichrist, got the deadly wound, but was healed. Do we see a wound that was healed in Daniel chapter 4? Remember Nebuchadnezzar? His kingdom was taken from him, right? And he was eating with the beasts of the fields. So we can say that Babylon, that Nebuchadnezzar, got like a deadly wound. Because what happened? He was reinstated in the kingdom another time. So if you want, you can call it for a wound that was healed. He got the power again. Back to power. So quite interesting parallel there also. And we know that, I believe, and actually we're going to spend a few hours later on going through Revelation 13 in relation to what we see today, because I believe we see the wound healing. Well, healing wound takes time, so I look forward to that class. Number 14 of the end time lessons in Daniel is there going to be a judgment of the wicked? So it says in Daniel 6:24, and remember here this is about the lion's den again, and it says, and the king commandment, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of the lions, them, their children, and their wives, and the lions had a mastery of them, and break all their bones in pieces, or ever they came at the bottom of the den. So again, our God is going to take care. The wicked will get their judgment, because we know we all have a free choice, and it's not that God enjoys torturing people, but ultimately there will be a judgment, and every man will have taken the side, and the judgment is not only about people perish, but the judgment is for us too. I mean, for the righteous. And may we all be one of the righteous and get to heaven. And here we see this picture we see through the whole Daniel, basically. In Daniel chapter 2, we have the stone, right, that is hitting the statue. And we have in Daniel 5, we have the writing on the wall, of the wall. We just read in Daniel 6, on the lion's den, but we have the writing on the wall here from God in Daniel 5, when the kingdom of Babylon was about to fall. You have been found to light. It says, and Babylon fell that night, in one night. Quite amazing. So fast. Such a great kingdom. And first angel's message. Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. So, and in verse in Revelation 22:12, it's talking about that. I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give everyone according to their what? Work. So, and then of course we have the ultimate destruction of sin and sinners. They will get their ultimate destruction. And then we're going to take a look at the seven last plagues later on, also, which is a kind of judgment from God to the earth. Okay, 15. So verse 26 in Daniel 3 to 30. Verse 26 to 30. It says, then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spoke, saying, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High, come out and come here. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came from the midst of the fire, and the satraps, administrators, governors, and the king's counselors gathered together, and they saw these men on whose bodies the fire had no power. The hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of the fire was not on them. Nebuchadnezzar spoke and saying, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree that any people, nation, or language which speaks anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver like this. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. So do you see that God will ultimately deliver his people in a miraculous way, even so in the end? And in Daniel's case also, he delivered Daniel. And also, God will give a reward to his people. These were promoted to higher positions in the kingdom. God really blessed them. And in Daniel, we see a similar story, or Daniel 6. All right. So, our reward is, of course, an eternal life and a crown, and to be able to live together with God. So we also have this assurance. Imagine that you are at an island. It's summer. It's nice. You're having your friends there. Maybe you're playing some games, and everything's just perfect. It's just the best summer you've had in a long time, and you're enjoying the sun and everything. Suddenly you see a policeman come up, and where you are, it's not a common sight, because you don't see much policemen around, but he's coming there, and he's heavily armed, and you're like, well, what's going on? And then suddenly he starts questioning this, and he said, I'm here to keep you safe, you know? We had an incident here, quite close, and I'm here to keep you safe. And they get a little bit of relief, but some are still skeptical. This is something weird here. And suddenly he takes up his rifle and starts shooting at people. And you and your friends, you run for life. And this keeps going and going and going, and you're hiding. And after 1 hour, you're trying to save your friends and help them. After 1 hour, you hear that the bullets are coming closer. This man is coming closer. You don't even know. There are more people here. And you decide, I need to jump into the water. That's the only way to escape. But the water is cold. And your clothes are, you have clothes, and they make you more heavy in the water. And you're trying. And then he's coming, and he's shooting some people there at the beach that have been trying to hide. And then he's starting to shoot at you. And he hits you in the leg, goes through your leg. And then you cry for help. You cry for help. And there you see a boat coming, and you cry for help to this boat. And he comes and picks you up. And you get to the shore. And now it seems like you're safe. This was a scenario for more than 600 people in Norway, 2011. Actually, close to where I have been living, an island there. And it was horrible. First, you had the bomb blew off in Oslo, and then the same man went there to this camp where more than 600 people were and started killing them, exactly, or just about like I described, and more, even more details. And then you have two of these that were saved. They were now safe at the beach. They were taken to a hotel, And there they, I mean, there they were naked, only covering themselves with a towel. I mean, they have been swimming and they have been taking off their clothes to escape. So they had a towel, you know, covering themselves. They were sitting there at the hotel, and then an old man approaches them. And he comes and he puts them in his arms. And then after a while, one of them looks up to the man. And she's like, she whispers to her friend, it's the king. It was the king of Norway. He had come there to comfort the people in this tragedy. And one day, we will be able to be in the arms of our God that will ultimately come and save us in the middle of this destruction here on this earth. And he will say, and by the way, this king, he said, he had come there, of course, to comfort them. And in this world of calamity, Christ will come with his comforting presence and words to us. And I'm very thankful for that, because as we have seen so far, this is going to be a serious time. And we get an idea how it will be looking to Daniel, in particular Daniel 3. And it's not going to be easy. We really need to get prepared for this time. I'll give you a break soon. Give you an overview of what we have been looking at, and then we're going to take some more minutes after the break to look at some other end time lessons. We have the image set up. All peoples and nations must worship. We have the combination of religion and state, death penalty, and we have the speaking with the voice of a dragon, and the people, God's people will keep his commandments. We have persecution of saints. We have God's people that will follow God, follow the Lamb wherever he goes. They're not going to be defiled by Babylon. They're going to be innocent before him, as described also of the 144,000. God's people are going to be tried in fire, and some of us even literally, I believe. I mean, we're going to be tortured, it's going to be a trying time. And I will give you this chart also later on. Jesus, but he is going to be with us, people, in these trials. We are going to see a wound that is healing, and we see that already, I believe. It's about to heal. And there will be a judgment on the wicked, ultimately. And then God will deliver his people and give them a reward. And one thing that we will take a look at also, righteousness by faith, which is the third angel. We can even see that in Daniel. So in Daniel, we see something very important, and that is the relationship between God's people and God. And we see one of the things that proved to be successful, that always will in the Christian life, is prayer. There was a preacher named Tony Evans. He was a little bit... what should I say, like worried for or scared for elevators. I don't know, maybe some of you are like, okay, an elevator is like a small box and I just don't want it to get stuck. I mean, that would be, I would freak out. I don't know if anyone of you are feeling like that, maybe. But he was. And he really, you know, I was thinking, man, I hope this is never going to happen to me. But one day it did. Between the floors, it got stuck. And people in the elevator, they freaked out and started banging the walls, help, help, and you know, no one came. But he was just standing there in the corner, even though he also felt like freaking out. But then he went to the door of the elevator, and to the wall of the elevator, and opened a small door there, took out the phone, got connected right away with someone on the other end, and said, we need help. And the help came. You know, he didn't need to freak out and bang the walls and windows or whatever was there in the elevator. He simply got connected. And this is how it is, how prayer is for us. And we see it in the example of Daniel, that through prayer, I mean, we can directly get connected with God. And in this world, we may at times get stuck, feel like we get stuck in different places, we get into trouble, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and like Daniel, oh, we're stuck again. But we can get connected with help right away through prayer. So we can trust in the power of prayer that there is someone on the other end that hears us, and that is God. For us in end times, we can be encouraged because we see someone has been through similar things earlier as Daniel and his friends. And we have a lot to learn there. And we have a text in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. It says, "Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus." It is because of the blood of Christ that we actually can come to God. And we know the sanctuary, and which we will talk more about later, but we know that through our prayers that you have the incense there going over the veil to the most holy place is representing our prayers. It's because of the ministration of Christ through this with this incense that we can get have access to God. Sometimes prayer though may take time. And we have example of that in Daniel as well, Daniel 10. And he was praying and fasting for 3 weeks. It took 3 weeks before the answer came. And we see then there in that, did you study this chapter? Or did you have any classes about it? Yeah. 10? No.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Anyhow, I study it because it's quite interesting. I mean, you see how it's basically showing the great controversy between good and evil, and how you know the angel Gabriel was fighting against the prince of Medo-Persia, or whatever, however it says there, let me check really quickly. It says that in verse 13 there, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. And what was the difference that made it work now? See what it says there in the following. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. So Michael made a difference. And who is Michael? The word Michael means who is like God, and that's the only one, and that is Christ. I think we will... Actually, we'll take a look at that later on, and we'll see that this is Jesus. But my point is, Jesus is the difference. He is the difference in this great controversy. And even through our prayers, this is the difference. This is the reason why we can pray. So sometimes Daniel wrote his prayers answered rapidly. Sometimes we do too. Other times it takes time. And now let's see some interesting things as we're going to wrap up this or finish this this class. And now we will spend some moments and we will find tracks of the three angels' messages in Daniel chapters 1 to 6. We know the first angel, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come. Worship Him," and so on, "who made the heaven, the earth, and the sea, and all that is in them." We'll start with fear God and give glory to Him. What does it mean to fear God? To fear God in Proverbs 8, it says, is to hate evil. Is it verse 13, I believe? Yes. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. And then Ecclesiastes 12, 13 talks about fear God and keep His commandments. So, fearing God... So hate evil is to honor Him and to keep His commandments. And in Daniel chapter, we find this in Daniel 3 and Daniel 6, right? We have seen how faithful they are, how they're hating evil, how they're keeping God's commandments, and they stand firm, all the three of Daniel's friends and Daniel himself. We see that right there. I mean, they were living this message. And in Daniel 1:8, it says, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself So what this is basically showing how we are to give glory to God. What does it say in 1 Corinthians 10:31? Whether you therefore eat or drink, do all to the glory of God. So it's about how we take care of our bodies, among other things. When in all we do, we're to give glory to God. And they did that. They chose the food that was best for them, and they didn't want to drink the king's wine and eat the king's meat. Okay. The hour of his judgment. Again, a little repetition of what we saw. We have judgment in Daniel 2. And what was that? How do we see the judgment there? What? We have the stone that is crashing the statue of the dream, right? That is God's kingdom coming, and it's hitting the feet that are the time of the end there, divided Europe. Then we have Daniel 3. What judgment do we find in Daniel 3? Well, we have the fiery furnace, and some of those who came close, they were burned. And also we, Nebuchadnezzar said also that, it would be a punishment for those who spoke against the God of these people. And then we have Daniel 4. What happened there? Nebuchadnezzar lost his kingdom. And 5, we have Belshazzar. His the kingdom of Babylon fell. Writing on the wall, they had the cup was full, and the judgment came. Daniel 6. The lion's den, we saw that those who had been, this was kind of a conspiracy against Daniel to make him fall, to catch him, because he was so God-fearing, he was doing so many things right, they couldn't find anything in him, but they said, if we can make some laws, we can propose some laws to the king that we may catch him, regarding his God, and that's how they caught him, and finally they were the ones thrown to the lion's den after Daniel was found alive, and innocence was found in him. Worship him. Well, pretty obvious. We have seen that, the main thing in what we have looked at now is about worship. Daniel 3 and Daniel 6. And, of course, this is also pointing toward the Sabbath in the end. And in Daniel 3, we see the image rites, and we know the also the image that will be set up in the end, and it's going to involve Sunday, it will be laws set up, mark of the beast. We also see Daniel, he was praying 3 times a day as a habit, and and then we have, of course, the refusing to bow down to this false god. So we see a difference. It's so important to see the difference between right and wrong worship. And for that we have the Word of God that is showing us. The second angel is about Babylon is fallen. And we see this in 2 instances in Daniel. One of them is when, if you have a king is representing a kingdom. In Daniel 4, we see how Nebuchadnezzar, how his kingdom was taken from him. He was eating together with a beast of the field, became crazy. So we can, in a sense, a kingdom without a king is not a kingdom. but even clearer, Daniel 5, we have that Babylon indeed was fallen in one night. And we know the spiritual Babylon is also fallen, and they were once standing, they were once following God, but at a certain time Babylon had fallen. Okay, It's quite interesting, by the way, that in Daniel 5, you see them drinking wine at this feast. And we know that, I mean, they were drinking from the cups from the sanctuary. They were not caring about the holy things. And we need to treat things holy that God calls holy. And wine is a symbolism of the doctrines that are corrupted in Babylon. So quite interesting symbolism there. But further so, more so, Jesus, you know, he drank of the cup of the wrath for us, for his people, so that we will not have to drink of it in the end, when the people, I mean, when it will be given unmixed with mercy. Because when everyone has taken a choice, the judgment will come. And it came upon Babylon. The third angel is about what? Worship, worshiping the beast, and the image, right? And it's a warning there what will take place. And we find it obviously in Daniel 3 and Daniel 6, and the threatening of if you don't worship this way, if you don't obey these laws, you will get killed. The same thing will take place in the end. There will also be a judgment. The law enforced together with this deceptive unity, combining church and state in opposition to those who are unified in truth, God's remnant. But Babylon will be judged. Babylon will be judged once. Then the third angel is also about righteousness by faith. And we see how in Revelation 14:12, what does it say? Exactly. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. Have the faith of Jesus, sorry. So, this is this about righteousness by faith? Yeah? basically, as I said earlier, those who try to kill God's people, they will also get their judgment. They will get killed. If you worship God, you will receive the wrath of man. If you worship man, you will receive the wrath of God. These are our choices. So, let us go to this verse here in Daniel 6. Then on 6:22 and 23, we read it, but let's read it again in this context about righteousness by faith. Daniel 6:22 to 23. My God sent his angel and shut the lion's mouth, that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before him. Isn't that what righteousness by faith is about? We believe, we accept his righteousness, then we will be counted as innocent. And also, O king, I have done no wrong before you. Now the king was exceedingly glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no injury was found on him, because what? Because he believed in his God. Righteousness by faith, right there. He believed in his God, that's why innocence was found in him. God's elect people believe in God, and innocence will be found in them, because they keep God's commandments. They are patient, they keep God's commandments. There are two important characteristics of God's elect people. They will not keep 9 of God's commandments. They will keep all 10 of them. And of course, this is God's work. We're not talking about this. I'm going to keep God's 10 commandments. No, it comes by faith. It's a gift. Grace is also transforming. So we also need grace to do the good works that God has put before us. This is what it's about, and we'll look more at this later on in the classes. All right. It was in the Korean War in the 1950s between North Korea and South Korea. We had North Koreans coming into South Korea, and they took over a small village. And then they took all the Christians there into a church. Maybe some of you heard this, but it's a good illustration. They took a picture of Jesus, put it outside the church, and they told the Christians there, okay, we want you to come now, or they took one by one, and they said, spit on the picture. If not, if you spit on the picture, you'll go free. If not, we'll kill you. That was their choice, okay? So the first Christian came, looked at the rifles, and really, you know, had to believe in Jesus, of course, but he was simply not ready. Spit on the pictures, and he walked over. Let him go. And the second Christian looked at the rifles, and he also believed in God, but when he saw the rifles, fear entered him, and I'm not ready for this. He went and spit on the picture. Then this little girl, around 13 years old, came, and she looked at the picture, looked at the rifles, and she believed in Jesus, and she was ready. She was ready for this, and instead of spitting at the picture, she took her dress and wiped off all the spit. And as she did this, she noticed something that happened. She looked up first and prayed this prayer. She said, "Dear Jesus, I know you love me, and you died for me." She said, "Lord, I'm willing to die for you." And then she looked up, or she closed her eyes and, you know, got ready to wait for the bullets. But no bullets came. And she tried to look at these people, and they were just, you know, they had come together in a small circle because they were so moved by what just happened and discussing, what are we going to do, you know? They admired the courage of her. I mean, they didn't like Christianity, but they admired her courage, and they made a decision, you know what, okay, they called back the two other Christians, and they let her go, and they shot them. So, those who did not have the courage to stand up, they were the ones that they shot. And, you know, as we see Daniel, how the courage that he has, the courage that his friends has, we need to ask ourselves, do we have the same courage? What would you do today if similar laws came? Would you be able to stand up for the truth? I mean, I think we are close to this, where there will be laws that we do not agree with, and even coming already. And we may be asked, do you want to follow them or not? You have a choice. If you don't follow them, you will get punished. This is right before us. So who wants a faith like Daniel and his friends? I want that faith. I want that courage. And I hope it's the same desire that you have, a faith that cannot be moved. So let us, I would like to end this message with a word of prayer, so you may bow your heads together with me, and we'll finish up. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for your truth, for your word, for your word that has a firm foundation. Thank you that we can live by it, and that it may give us life and help in time of need, and that it may also prepare us for harder times. I pray, Lord, that it may prepare us for times ahead, because there are hard times ahead, Lord. We barely know what is going to happen. We get a glimpse of it in Revelation, and also now through Daniel, as we have seen a picture of what will take place. Help us to stand firm, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.